Good morning. Stand to your feet if you would as we enter into the presence of God with worship and with singing.
I know
clap of praise. It's good to be in the house of the Lord. Amen.
Amen.
Good morning. Welcome here to Light of Christ Church. My name is Rich Guinto. I'm the worship pastor here. Just thankful that you could be here on this beautiful day. This is the time in the service where we take just a few moments to turn around, say hi to a few faces you do know, and several faces you don't know. We'll give you that time right now. Thank you, guys. You can be seated for a moment.
Well, good morning. I'm Marianne Romanat. I'm the lead pastor here, and it's so good to see you here with us to worship God together. Praying that God will lead to us the people he has in mind for Light of Christ, and so we're glad you're here, that you're an answer to our prayer. And I do see several new faces this morning. If you would, open your bulletins, and on the right side, let's tear off the communication card. And there's a place there just for you to tell us a little bit about you, especially if this is your first or second time visit. Be sure you fill that out so we can get to know you and be praying for you. And on the back side, there's a place to actually share specific prayer requests. If this is your first time with us, we have a gift for you right outside these double doors to the right. There's a welcome center, and we invite you to stop by there and pick that up before you leave today. And you can drop these cards in our offering when they come around later in the service. All right, so let's continue to worship God. Let's stand together.
1, 2, 3, 4. Gonna be
Thank you.
Lord, we thank you for the sacrifice. That the veil is torn in two so we can come boldly before your throne. Be your children. Thank you in Jesus' name. Everyone can be seated. Thank you.
Well, we're in a sermon series right now that we're calling Fruitful, and it's based on a book by Bishop Robert Snazy. He did some research about congregations that were vital, congregations that were growing and active in their faith and really making disciples. And he talked about five things that he consistently saw in those churches. And so we're talking about each one week to week. And I'm also sharing with you during these sermons the results of an online survey that we took during the month of July about how we're doing in those five areas. And how can we become more fruitful than we are today into the future? So those five practices that he observed are radical hospitality, passionate worship, intentional faith development, risk-taking mission and service, and extravagant generosity. So today we'll focus on risk-taking mission and service. Specifically, we'll look at the risk. What is that all about, risk-taking? What does that mean? And I would suggest to you that the risk involved in mission and service is relationship, developing relationships with those that we serve and those with whom we serve. I want us to have a prayer together, and I want to ask you, as we bow our heads, just lay your hands open, palmed up on your lap, just ready to, letting God know we're ready to receive a word from him today. Let us pray. Come, Holy Spirit, and speak to your church. Speak to each daughter and son of yours. Meet us in this time of listening to your word so that we might be enlivened and sent out in your name, willing to risk relationship so that we might know Jesus. And it's his name we pray. Amen. Amen. She came to church with two black eyes. She had clothes on that had not been washed for some time. Her hair had not been brushed that morning. And when she spoke, she mumbled. She had not been to church in decades. She had been rejected in the past by people who called themselves Christians, and she had sworn that she would not set foot in a church again. I knew who she was, and when I saw her walking in at the back, I was very surprised. I was thrilled for her that she was taking that step, but I was also concerned, and when I saw that she had two black eyes, I wondered if people in the congregation would be willing to go to her and greet her, or if they would feel uncomfortable not knowing what to do. And I also wondered what had happened to her. Her name was Marty. And a few weeks before, she had come to the church for assistance. She had gone to the food pantry and received some food for her family. And then she had asked for help in paying a bill that she had that she could not pay. And I got to hear some of her story. A family member attended our church and had been inviting her to come for a long time. And she had said, absolutely not. So when I saw her, as you can imagine, I was very happy for her. My concern about the congregation was unfounded. Before I could even get to her, I noticed that people were walking over and shaking her hand and saying, "We're so glad you're here." Through them, Jesus was throwing his arms around her to embrace her, to fan the flame of that first step into the church. My heart swelled. A few months later, I sat in a booth in a donut shop across from Marty. She had taken the membership class. She had learned about our beliefs and our mission. She was learning about her own spiritual gifts. And she told me how much it meant to her that she had found a church where she was welcome and where she could grow in her faith. And it meant the world to me because I knew that that relationship that we had risked with her was where this had all begun. And I knew that that was really what the church is all about. When vital churches risk relationship as they do mission and service, lives are changed. Christian speaker and author Shane Claiborne has discovered many times over the truth of this, that it really is all about relationships. He and some friends have initiated an intentional Christian community. They live together in community, and they live among the poor and serve the poor in Philadelphia. You may have heard of him before. He is pretty well known in Christian circles, but if you haven't, you need to know about him. He wrote about his experiences of how serving among the poor, knowing them, having relationships with them, has changed his life and the lives of those in his community. He talks about how relationship with the least of these in our society is transforming both for the powerful and the powerless, the well-resourced and the needy. The power of Christ is in relationships, and all are changed by God's love. He took a survey one time of Christians, and he shared some of the results from that survey in his book called The Irresistible Revolution. And I want to read to you one bit of those results that he shared. He wrote, "I asked participants who claimed to be strong followers of Jesus whether Jesus spent time with the poor. Nearly 80% said yes. Later in the survey, I sneaked in another question. I asked this same group of strong followers whether they spent time with the poor, and less than 2% said they did. I learned a powerful lesson. We can admire and worship Jesus without doing what he did. We can applaud what he preached and stood for without caring about the same things. We can adore his cross without taking up ours. I came to see that the great tragedy of the church is not that rich Christians do not care about the poor, but that rich Christians do not know the poor." Jesus speaks about this risk-taking missions and service in his parable in Matthew 25 of the goats and the sheep. And I'm going to ask Kyle to come up and read that for us in just a minute. In this parable, the king at the end of time separates all of humanity into two groups, the sheep and the goats. The sheep are God's people, and he puts them on his right hand, and then the goats are not God's people, and they're on his left hand. So let's listen, first of all, to what he has to say to the sheep. Ready? I love telling Kyle what to do. It's really fun. And I'm actually going to ask him to stay up and read another passage after this one. So I have lots to tell you this morning. Okay. Right.
Okay. Matthew 25:34. "Then the king will say to those on his right, 'Come, you who are blessed by my Father, take your inheritance, the kingdom prepared for you since the creation of the world. For I was hungry, and you gave me something to eat. I was thirsty, and you gave me something to drink. I was a stranger, and you invited me in. I needed clothes and you clothed me. I was sick and you looked after me. I was in prison and you came to visit me.' Then the righteous will answer him, 'Lord, when did we see you hungry and feed you, or thirsty and give you something to drink? When did we see you a stranger and invite you in, or needing clothes and clothe you? When did we see you sick or in prison and go to visit you?' The king will reply, 'I'll tell you the truth. Whatever you did for the least of these brothers of mine, you did for me.'"
Okay, thank you. All right. So in verse in verse 40, Jesus identifies himself, doesn't he, with the least of these, with those in our society who are in need in any way, okay? And he names specifically what some of those needs are. I love in Mother Teresa's book, In My Own Words, she wrote about this verse, "We should not serve the poor like they were Jesus. We should serve the poor because they are Jesus." There's something about being with those who have need in any way, whether it be physical need, spiritual need, emotional need. We all have needs, right? But being together in that need helps us to encounter the cross. And so therefore, we know Jesus. So Jesus is making a promise and saying that if we will spend time with the least of these, we will meet him there. And that's a beautiful promise that he gives. Our second reading is from the 58th chapter of Isaiah. And in these words of Isaiah, we hear God saying that true worship is really about a lifestyle of justice. So let's listen to what Isaiah has to say.
"It is not the kind of fasting I have chosen to loose the chains of, is not the kind of fasting I have chosen to loosen the chains of injustice and untie the cords of the yoke, to set the oppressed free and break every yoke? Is it not to share your food with the hungry and to provide the poor wanderer with shelter when you see the naked, to clothe him and not to turn away from your own flesh and blood? Then your light will break forth like the dawn, and your healing will quickly appear. Then your righteousness will go before you, and the glory of the Lord will be your rear guard. Then you will call, and the Lord will answer. You will cry for help, and he will say, "Here I am."
Thank you. So in the prophets, we hear over and over again similar concerns for those who are the least of these. It's not just Isaiah. Throughout the Old Testament prophets, we see over and over again concern for four groups in particular: for the poor, for the alien, or in other words, immigrant, for the widow, and for the orphan. We hear that over and over again. So God is really impressing upon Israel, and therefore us, what he is most concerned about. Again, the least of these, my brothers and sisters. But what's so interesting about this passage from Isaiah 58 is that Isaiah takes it a step further. He doesn't just talk about the needs, supplying the needs. He also talks about the risk of relationship when he says, "And not turning away from your own flesh and blood." Isn't that beautiful? So it's not just about meeting a need. It's not just practical. It's relational. That indeed we are all part of God's family. And in that family, in those relationships, is where we find the presence of God. There was a 2009 movie that I'm sure you're aware of called The Blind Side, and it tells the true story of football player Michael Orr and his journey from being a homeless teenager to being a big-time football player, all because of the care of Sean and Leanne Toohey. It's a true story. In this first clip we're going to watch, we'll see how Michael ended up coming to live with them and how much he needed someone to care. Let's watch. Orr.
Big Mike. Hey, my name's Leanne Toohey. My kids go to Wingate. You said you were going to the gym? School gym's closed. Why were you going to the gym? Big Mike, why were you going to the gym?
Because it's warm.
Do you have any place to stay tonight? Don't you dare lie to me.
Seen that look many times. She's about to get her way.
Come on. Come on.
SJ, make room. Get inside.
Come on.
Here you have a desk.
Keep going.
Four.
Oh, not that one. That's all right.
Here you have a desk, chest of drawers, you have a nightstand, a light, an alarm. Oh, and Sean says all the pro athletes use futons if they can't find a bed big enough, so I got you one of those. Of course, the frame was heinous. It's not about to let that in my house, but I got you something nicer.
It's mine?
Yes, sir. What?
Never had one before.
What, a room to yourself?
A bed.
Well, you have one now.
And so what happens is the Toohey family is transformed. Their relationship with Michael progresses to the point that he truly is part of their family. And so then when Christmas time comes around and they shoot a picture for their Christmas card, he is part of the picture. And Leanne, in real life and in the movie, is a very bold woman, so she's not afraid to speak out when she encounters bigotry among her friends. She goes to a lunch in this next scene we're going to watch, and their reaction about his being part of their family causes her to speak up. So let's watch.
Teeny tiny next to him, right? Like Jessica Lange and King Kong?
Hey, does Michael get the family discount at Taco Bell? Because if he does, Sean's going to lose a few stores.
He's a good kid.
Well, I say you make it official and just adopt him.
He's going to be 18 in a few months. Doesn't really make much sense to legally adopt.
Leanne, is this some sort of white guilt thing?
What will your daddy say?
Before or after he turns over in his grave? Daddy's been gone 5 years, Elaine. Make matters worse, you were at the funeral. Remember? You wore Chanel in that awful black hat. Look, here's the deal. I don't need y'all to approve my choices, all right? But I do ask that you respect them. You have no idea what this boy's been through, and if this is gonna become some running diatribe, I can find an overpriced salad a lot closer to home.
Leanne, I'm so sorry. We didn't intend to...
No, we didn't, really.
I think what you're doing is so great. To open up your home to him, and... Honey, you're changing that boy's life.
No. He's changing my...
You're changing that boy's life. No. He's changing mine. That's really what it means, isn't it, to be a Christian? To allow ourselves to be humbled by the presence of Christ in relationships. And she got it. She understood it. That it's really about what God was doing in her life and how she could be part of it, how she could just jump on board what God was up to in her life. And that's true for all of us. Just being open to people. It goes so far. Allowing God to call us to risk our way out of complacency and apathy. Discovering Jesus when we step outside of our comfort zones. That's when it happens. When we get to know people who are different from us, who have a different kind of story, and who are on their way to know God as well. The risk in risk-taking mission and service is family. Not just caring about people in need, but knowing people who have real needs. People who don't think, dress, talk, vote, or smell like me. So often, that is where we meet the living Christ. The church is not just about giving money and trying to bring change that way, although, of course, that is important. Giving, financial giving to mission is very important because we make an impact that way, too. But part of our responsibility as the church is to make sure that you have opportunities to develop relationships, to widen the circle of family so that all are part of the family of God. I want to take a look now at the three questions in our survey that we took in July about risk-taking mission and service and see what you had to say. The first one said, I believe that light of Christ is, 75% of you said focus outward on the needs of those outside our church community. So this is a strength for us. That indicates that. 10% said focused on the needs of those in our church more than we are of those outside of our church. So there's some room for growth there in our perception. Focused on the need to preserve the church itself rather than on the least of these. So that's kind of like an institutional maintenance question. And only 3% said that. So that's a very good sign. And then finally, not sure. Perhaps that was just not really being aware of how we are involved in mission. That was 12% said that. Second question, in terms of mission and service, I see Light of Christ as very concerned about the needs of the least of these and involved in mission in a hands-on way. That was 78%. Again, a strength. Concerned about the needs of the least of these, but not very involved in making a difference. That was 16%. So again, there's room for growth there. And perhaps that's kind of a sense of we mean well, but we're not really doing the follow-through that we want to do. So again, that's area for growth. And then fairly uninvolved, only 3%. Not sure, only 3%. And then finally, in terms of my own involvement, so in this question, we're turning it back to the person taking the survey, back to you. In terms of my involvement, I regularly serve in a hands-on way with mission opportunities that Light of Christ offers. That was 40% of us. Regularly serve in a hands-on way outside of Light of Christ, with other churches or organizations that are addressing needs, 10%. So half of us say we're regularly serving in mission and service, okay? Then the other half of us, 42% said infrequently serve with mission opportunities. So a lot of us are saying, this is a struggle for me. I'm having trouble with, you know, making the space in my life, right? I mean, life is full, isn't it? So making space for that. 42% of us say we need to do better with that. And then finally, am unable to be involved, 7%. I imagine maybe that was, again, constraints of life, time, and that kind of thing. And then unwilling was only 1%. So there, that shows us that, you know, again, there's that time factor coming back to us, that we need to make space for God, make space for our church in that question. So I have to say, when looking at those questions, that our youth have been a beautiful example for us this summer. If you're not aware, our youth spent every Wednesday this summer going out and serving in some way with a mission opportunity. I really feel that they constantly set the bar high for us in this regard. But one of the things that Abby Thomas, our youth pastor, reflected for me was that she saw some real growth in our youth this summer with being involved with relating to those they served. And in particular, she said she saw this at Sunrise Assisted Living, which is an assisted living facility, and they went there to do some singing, and they've done that before, and the youth were saying they really enjoyed that, and they feel they're getting to know the residents and what they like, what they don't like, and that they would like to continue that relationship. So that's a beautiful thing. Again, becoming family, increasing the circle of God's family. When we serve, we realize, we're reminded that is our job, is to constantly widen that circle, to welcome more in, to know God, to seek God together. And I've been reflecting on that as I've been thinking about this topic, and I've noticed that God has been bringing different people into our church family from different backgrounds, different faith stories, and I just so appreciate how God has been bringing people who are from very different places, very different backgrounds together, and how we are embracing and welcoming to all. And this was really driven home for me recently when I started teaching the Discover Light of Christ class this time. There was a woman in that class named Zinnia Notram. She's right here in the back. And Zinnia shared with us, as we went around the room and introduced ourselves, she shared with us that she is from a small country that is within the boundaries of South Africa called Lesotho. And she just moved here a few months ago. She shared with the class that the reason she came here is because her daughter, Impo, and her son, Max, are here, and they are part of this church. And so she told us, she said, I came here, and I knew no one but them. But she said, now, because of this church, I have a new family. It was very touching for all of us. Tears came to my eyes when she said that, because I thought, that really is what it's all about. And I wanted to share that with you. All have family here. That's what the church is, a place where all can have family. And that especially includes those brothers and sisters who are the least of these, as Jesus described. And he just said that they are a constant sign to us that he is in our midst, that when you serve together, then you have served Jesus. Vital churches make sure that the family circle is widened to include those who have little in the way in this world, in this life, those who have nowhere to turn, those who have made mistakes in their life, those whose lives are broken. Vital churches reach out through risk-taking service and mission, bringing about the kingdom of God. May Light of Christ always be a church like that. Let us pray. Oh God, we thank you for the concern that you've placed in our hearts, and I've seen that so much in Light of Christ, God, that concern for others, and especially those who have needs, that need to be addressed. We pray, Lord, that it would not be just about meeting needs, but that it would be about people. We pray that our family could be expanded by your grace, that we might welcome those whom we serve in a deep way, so that our lives are transformed. Continue to guide this church, God, by your Holy Spirit, so that we might have the heart you have. And we lift it to you in Jesus' name. Amen. I want to invite you during the Song of Reflection to come and pray. If you would like to meet God here, you're welcome to come and kneel and have a time of prayer during this next song. Expect to walk without you.
What you pray, I pray. What you pray, I pray. Where you go, I go. What you say, I say, God. What you pray, I pray. What you pray, I pray.
Good morning. My name is Abby Thomas, and I'm the youth pastor here. And I just want us to look to the screens for just a minute for some video announcements that we have.
Being a Christian really went from being like a routine, coming to like Sunday school every Sunday, to really being reality. Because you have to wake up early, and it shows that being Christian is really not the easiest thing. Especially in high school, this is my freshman year, and it's really hard. You have to say no to a lot of things that other people go right on with.
There's only one foundation. We believe in God the Father. We believe in Jesus Christ. We believe in the Holy Spirit, and He's given us new life. We believe in the crucifixion. We believe that He conquered death.
Mr. Leno, heading to church. Why don't you go ahead and hop on then? Oh, come on, Mr. Leno. I know you'll like it. It's got to be better than what you're doing. What are you doing? Okay. I know what you're thinking. Church is boring, or I've got stuff to do, or John, you don't shower regularly, okay? That's it. I ain't playing games no more. Get in the car. Miss, get in the car. Don't make me come over. You think I won't come over there? You think I won't come over there? I will come over there. I will pick you up. Put you in my pocket, carry you across the street, put you in this car, strap you in, and take you to church. And if you think I'm playing, if you think I'm playing, you just try me. Try me. I'm a secret agent, and your life is in extreme danger. You need to get in this car right now. All right, now you're booked. Now I don't even want you in the car. Matter of fact, don't get up. Don't come in the car on the passenger side and buckle the safety belt, because you are not allowed in my car. This is a no Mr. Little zone. Please come with me. If I bring somebody to church, I get a free item from the cafe. Look at me. Do you really want to come between me and a free Davis? Okay, I think I got it. Mr. Little, would you like to go to church with me? Yes. That's brilliant. Brilliant, I say. I'm a genius.
The vast majority of unchurched people are likely to come to church if invited, but only a handful of people ever invite even their friends or family. So many times we think of all the people who would benefit from the great teaching when we are already in church. This week, find the right words and invite them. Encourage them, or even pick them up. So many people just need to be asked.
Okay, showtime. Morning, Mr. Little.
And we have one more announcement. Next Sunday, in addition to confirmation starting Sunday night from 5 to 6 p.m., we have a youth and parent meeting. So come out for that. We're going to be looking at some big events that are happening throughout the year and get those dates on your calendar. Go ahead at the beginning of the school year. So we invite you to come out for that next Sunday.
And we want to pray now, and I want to just share with you, in case that you didn't read the communication this week by email, that Abby Thomas, our youth pastor, has submitted her resignation, and her last day with us is going to be September 28th. We're happy that the reason is because she's accepted a new position that we feel is a God thing at Hickory Grove Christian Church. Christian School. It's a school, and it's a teaching position with middle and high school students in the areas of drama and chorus. So keep her in your prayers. She's already begun there, and she's also working here, so there's a lot going on. Plus, she's continuing with her education at Pfeiffer, her seminary degree there. So a lot going on these days, but she's transitioning the role, and we've begun a search for a new youth pastor. So let us pray. We give you thanks, God, for all the ways that you're with us and with your church. We thank you for Abby and her wonderful gifts, the ways that she's impacted the lives of many young people here at Light of Christ. God, we just pray that the seeds that she has planted will continue to grow. We pray for our youth as they adjust to this news and as they prepare their hearts for this change. We pray, God, that you will bless all those who are stepping forward to assist in this transition, parents and volunteers who are such a blessing to our youth. We pray that you would give us all your Holy Spirit. We pray that Abby will be able to serve you in this new role at the school, that you would give her wisdom and insight and guidance. We pray for our search, that you would bring just the right person to be our next youth pastor. We pray that that would be guided by your hand, God. And Lord, we lift up those who need our prayers today, those who are struggling with the loss of a loved one. In particular, we pray for Lee Stone and her family at the death of her cousin this week. We lift her up to you. We also pray for those who are healing from surgeries or illness. Pray that you'd lay your healing hand on them. And God, now as we offer our offerings to you, we pray that they would be used to glorify you and that you would guide our church in using what we give to bring the kingdom on earth. We also offer ourselves to you, Lord, for to be used by you in mission and service as we risk relationship with others. Thank you for hearing our prayers. We love you, Lord. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen.
You would stand to your feet as we worship God in our tithes and offerings.
Well, my parting word to you today is to encourage you before you leave today to get organized about the upcoming church-wide study, Unbinding Your Heart. It's going to start next week, if you can believe that. It's already here. And so our groups will start meeting Sunday through Saturday of next week, not this week. There is a sign-up in the lobby about it. The basic idea of the study is that we need to be unbound in our hearts, that we need to deepen our relationship with God in order to have something to share with others. So I hope that you'll step out there and take a look and become part of one of those groups. Go in peace to love and serve the Lord. Amen.